Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We have another full house here at the Innovation Lab. Thank you for staying with us and enjoying the content we're putting together. So I'm going to talk a little bit more slowly here because, as you can see, two of our seats are empty. Two of our speakers are on their way and will be in here in just a moment, but I'm certain that we can begin. Pano, Anthos from XRC Labs, do you want to take it away and
yep.
We'll start going?
Thank you, Alan.
Ladies and gentlemen, Pano, Anthos.
Thank you. So this is going to be the most amazing panel of this conference, okay? Let me just say right now, this is going to be it. It's 1:30 on a Sunday afternoon. The sun is shining. The fact that you all are awake is amazing. All right, so today we're going to do something really different. How many of you are entrepreneurs? Raise your hands. Not bad. All right, small sample. So what we're going to do today is get inside their head. Like, what on earth made them do what they're doing? What motivates them? What drives them? Part of adopting any sort of innovation or using it or deploying it is you got to kind of understand, like, what's driving them? What's making this tick? Why? You know, why aren't they, like, just get a big corporate job? No offense to the corporate people here. But, you know, what's driving this process? So quick background on us. XRC Labs is a retail and technology accelerator, consumer goods, and we've backed about 48 companies so far in less than 2 years. So we see a lot of these folks. They are the entrepreneurs. They're where all the innovation's happening. And so we see a lot of this, and so I thought every panel usually is about AI and robotics, which, by the way, we did earlier today, or, you know, whatever. We made this happen, or we did this, or we did that. But I wanted to kind of change it up a little bit and say, let's get inside their heads. Let's figure out what's really going on here and help also you all understand when they present to you and they think, come on, you just need to do this, why you're not doing it so fast, right? You have a little more patience with each other. Okay, so what we're going to do is have a short introduction of each company, no sales pitches here, just so you get some background on who they are and what they're about. And then we're going to get into the, like, okay, let's get inside your head. And but this is not a psychology or psychiatry session. I am not certified at all of any sort, but we should have a lot of fun with this, okay? Cool. All right, so on my left, starting on my left, is Francis Pitonti from Lexet. And I'm going to have Lexet and Francis introduce himself, and then we'll go on from there. Please.
Hi, my name's Francis. Lexet is it's an API toolkit for furniture retailers who are building augmented reality and search applications. And the mission with Lexet is to take context and help you perform searches or product recommendations based on your environment, based on the quality and configuration of your space.
So let me try to summarize. Augmented reality.
Yep.
Home furnishings.
Yep.
Value prop is?
We're an AI decorating tool to help
you. Decorating tool. Cool. All right. I need a lot of help.
All right.
Asaf.
So good afternoon, and thank you for your time. My name is Asaf. I'm coming from the online industry that already proved itself. And in the last 2 years, we are converting our tools and techniques that already make sense and a lot of money online, bringing them to where you guys really need them, offline, where 90% of the income is. We were at XRC. We are from Israel, starting to grow in the US right now, and we will tell more about it in the next few minutes.
Excellent. Joe.
Yeah, hi. I'm Joel. I'm the CEO of Trax. Trax is a global company that took a mission to digitize and augment the entire brick and mortar FMCG stores. So we take normal day experience at brick and mortar stores, the likes of Walmart, 7-Eleven, and augment them in a way that the whole store in terms of SKUs, products, are all digitized and accessible for anyone to use and interact with.
Awesome. And last but not least, Sam Vashish from Magia AI.
Yeah, so I'm sorry, what the question's about Magia?
Just a little background, yeah.
Oh, myself. Hi, I'm Sam Vasishta. I'm the Chief Marketing Officer and Co-Founder at Magia. We're an AI company. We're building virtual sales assistants. This is actually my third company doing virtual assistants. And the first two were both successful companies acquired by, one acquired by Cisco, the other one by TiVo. So it seems like this same thing over and over again, but it just keeps getting better and better, and the market keeps getting better and better. So looking forward to what this one brings.
So you're not insane then? You're not doing the same thing over and over again, expecting a different result?
No, I'm doing the same thing over and over again, expecting the same result.
Exactly.
So I'm
right.
Really crazy.
Okay, good, good, good. All right, so we're going to start with you, Sam. We're going to kind of go reverse order now. So you've gotten a little background on what each of these companies do. So Sam, you've been an entrepreneur now, you said, three times. This is your third?
Third company doing virtual assistants, yeah.
Virtual assistants, okay. All right, so Sam, come on. Like, what is motivating you? Like, a virtual assistant? Like, what is driving you on this? What's burning you up and just making you do this, besides money, which I'm sure is not the prime issue here?
So in the world of startups, it's not about being crazy to do something. It's about being crazy enough to do something. So you really have to be passionate about it. You have to have almost a pig-headed perspective or pig-headed attitude towards it that you're just going to somehow power through things. And I've never really sat down and thought about what's the formula or what is the equation that is driving this. But a couple of things. One is that you see a lot of things moving online. So whether it's retail or a lot of things that we do on a day-to-day basis is going online. I was in the video industry before. That's gone online considerably. And so the only thing that's not going online is the human touch. That's actually falling way behind. And consequently, on the flip side, what's happening is because of this shift, the emphasis, and I'm speaking from an outsider's perspective, you guys might feel differently about it, but from a the causal result of this shift is that the emphasis on human selling in stores has also dwindled, and that's multiple factors. Changing formats, changing products, so on and so forth. But typically when I go to a store, I'm not really expecting to get the kind of help that I need. So when you put those two things together and you realize that if there's a way to bring this human touch wherever a shopper might go, that should be an opportunity. So that's how we got started on this, and we'll see if it's right or not.
All right, so we're going to do some real-time polling. How many of you have been dissatisfied with in-store assistant experience? Raise your hands. All right, Sam.
There you go.
There you go.
We might be onto something.
So you could all be doing Sam's business right now. You've got the personal pain to feel it. All right, Joe. Joel.
So Trax started actually from a meeting with 7 years ago with the head of innovation for Procter & Gamble. And he came to us and said that he has a big problem around shelf execution at retail brick and mortar stores, and was a big blind spot of not knowing what activation happens on those shelves, what kind of competing products do they have around their own Procter & Gamble products, all the commercial policies, where they're being adhered, promotions, activations, marketing materials, and he was wondering if there is any technology that can solve that issue. We came together, built a company, built a technology that can really augment the shelf in real time using image recognition and computer vision. And this is how it all started. So we started in Venezuela. They sent us there, being the toughest place on Earth, to try and solve that problem in terms of the retail environment over there. We managed to do it there, and the rest is history.
Wow. So, all right, next poll. How many of you have tried to buy something in a store, but it was out of stock? Raise your hand. Another good problem. Another good problem. Excellent. Okay, Asaf, you're next.
So I will answer your question first, what makes me try to do what I do. So first of all, it's not me, and I think a startup that is talking about himself need to grab some more power, and the power is always coming from the group. I'm working with my friends, which are my partners, and we are second-time entrepreneurs. And our goal is just to build something that makes... It was me. We want to build something that makes things better. We want to impact and to create a result that can be measured. And if we can reach to a 100% impact, I think that this is the goal. Because then it's very easy to understand if you're doing something well or not. When we are facing the technology of the next generation, if we call it like this, we will see that every place that a machine is making decisions, it's making it just a little bit better because it can calculate a lot more data than a human being. Stores are working solo. What I mean is that like stores are not handled by people like they used to be. There are no salespersons anymore. Salespersons are there to help you to get something if you ask them. But if you go to Zara, no one will come and say, hey, I want to show you something just for you. No. So the only salesperson that is relevant 100% of the time is the store. But the store is way back, 100 years ago, looks the same, use paper signs, use mannequins that are changed once a month. So we said, okay, this is a place that a machine didn't touch yet. This is what we do for 7 years. We make decisions. We make machines get decisions about what is the best traffic source we should buy or what is the best ad we should show to a specific customer. Now we're just converting the same tools and technique, making the stores by using small digital signage to do exactly what the salesperson used to do 10 years ago. So you walk in the store, 100% impact because you just need to look at the display and the display will react to you by showing you exactly what's the right fit for you.
Perfect, thank you, good. All right, Francis.
Yeah, so myself and my co-founder, Leslie Karpis, we're both former architects. And designing a space, oh, sorry. Hello, is this better?
Yeah.
Yeah, so myself and my co-founder, we're both former architects. And shopping for furniture online is really hard. You don't know how it feels, you don't know how it looks, you don't know the ergonomics of it. Finding styles that match is very difficult. There's so many parameters and there's so many things to match up to find something that works. And interior designers are very expensive and inaccessible. And I guess both of us coming from this world, realizing, well, if humans are doing this and this is an aggregate of historical knowledge, these design decisions, we thought, well, maybe we can use artificial intelligence to make these decisions. And we built this company with the intention of streamlining that decision-making process and understanding context and understanding an environment in order to help you pick out the right products to fit that space.
So I'm going to start with you, Francis. We're going to go reverse back again. Okay, lots of machines, right? This is technology, it's all machines. We're not talking about having 1,000 people in a country do work for you, per se, right? This is technology, it's automated. What is really disruptive about this? I mean, look, you agreed to be on this panel, so you have to answer the question. but the reality is like, it seems like, does anyone have like any of you interior designers? No, didn't think so. Wrong conference. Sorry, you probably got into the wrong show. but the reality is none of us really are probably very good at interior design. All right? So anything's better than nothing. But why is this in particular disruptive?
Well, it's disruptive because we're increasing access to a body of knowledge that would have otherwise been very hard to get access to. You either have to buy your way into it or spend years studying a topic and understanding how to make the...
So what if I buy the wrong chair? Big deal. I mean, my house looks ugly. I mean, is that really what it comes down to?
There's a lot of studies that show being in a nice environment increases health. It increases your positive outlook. It makes you happier. It makes a better world. I mean, if we're in nice environments, we feel better. I mean, think of really bad office space, full of fluorescent lights, and you just feel sick all day, and you look at the same gray cubicles and the chair that's got the wheel broken off, and you know, it makes you feel bad.
How many of you are happy with your office environment? Raise your hands. 10, 20%. Okay, right. So you could do other than uplift. How many of you believe that if you had a better office environment, you would work better? Raise your hands. Ooh, nice, okay. So we got some disruption here, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So who gets disrupted in this equation?
I think probably the interior design industry.
Got it. Does anyone, I don't even know any interior designers.
So
they're out there somewhere, right?
They're going to be fine.
Okay. All right. Cool. Or are you unlocking something? Disruption can really be two types, right?
I think we're unlocking something. I mean, I think we're bringing these tools to a market that wouldn't be using those services necessarily, right?
Right.
I mean, I think what we're doing is we're giving something that might have been inaccessible and a luxury, and we're making it that everybody can, you know, it'll just become part of your e-commerce experience when you're shopping for furniture. It won't be something you have to go out and seek extra.
Very cool. Okay, Asaf, what's disruptive about having screens in stores?
So screens in stores, it's not new. It's there for years. Actually, the simplicity in that, it's what's interesting, because when we are going to retailers, we ask them, how many people are looking at your mannequins? Or what's the value of your digital signage that is showing the same video for 4 months? So actually, we find that they don't know the answer. The mannequins are there because they are there, and no one knows exactly what's the value of the paper sign that shows this item for 30% off. So actually, when you look at something very simple, and you just make people understand that your store is responsible for your sales, but it's acting exactly the same like it used to act for 100 years. At the same time, retailers become very smart. They are smart. They are smart only on 10% of their business online. They know that when they arrange the website according to what makes sense, they uplift the sales. But they are not thinking about doing the same in the stores. So we find the simple solution a big game changer that actually takes the most important part of the business and make it a little bit more smart and dynamic.
So what's disruptive about this? This seems like this is just like table stakes.
It's the ability to take data on real time. Sales reports, loyal customers, trends, sales online, and on the other hand, use screens that are looking at the customers. They recognize a man, 40 years old, and a woman, 25 years old, and only by looking at the screen is able to show you exactly what's the right fit for you and according to data.
Minority Report.
Exactly. This is the movie we just showed in the booth, it's right over here on the entrance.
Got it, okay. How many of you work for retailers? Show of hands. Okay, how often do you change your Windows displays? I'm gonna ask you, raise your hands based on what I ask. Once a month. Once every 2 months. Once every 3 months.
Wow.
Once every 4 months. Ever. All right, so we don't get a lot of change on the Windows, right? That's a pretty ironic thing, don't you think, that the Windows don't change that frequently? I change my clothes every day. Why doesn't the window change, right?
Yep.
The weather changes. All right, Joel, what's disruptive about what you're up to?
So Trax is disruptive in a few dimensions. The first disruption we did is really on the technology side to be able to unlock this capability of looking from computer vision standpoint on shelves and understanding the SKUs on the shelf in a very high granularity. Today we recognize that 98% accuracy in real time. In NRF, for the first time, we are presenting a fully automated on-premise recognition. In the past, we had to send the images to the cloud and to enjoy much stronger processing power, and today we do it in the store itself. So that's the first disruption that unlocks other disruptions. And today, retailers are able to really monitor the shelves in every SKU, in every position, every shelf tag in real time. Misplaced product, out of stock, on the shelf during the day, misplaced items, items that are blocking other items, promotions in the end caps and exhibitions that are running out of products. A lot of disruption around how the store is being executed. Another disruption is around category management. Category management is using companies like JDA and Nielsen with Spaceman to do kind of a lot of human wisdom and experience how to best categorize and shelf the products in the best way. But normally, those planograms are being reused again and again in multiple number of stores without any adherence to the specific store's locations and specific store demographics. Today, we do that all of that in an automated way. So we can take all the shelf data that we collect, we correlate it with point of sale data, and we can scientifically predict and analyze and give recommendations which are scientifically based, what is the best planogramming for each and every store. So you'll be coming from a centralized category management to a very store-by-store level. So the real disruption is in the capability to really take the whole entire retail
and augment it and digitize it in real time on every SKU level, and then the disruption is coming from there. We believe eventually we will place this type of a technology also in the hands of consumers. And imagine that today everybody knows that from the day-to-day walking into the store, you want to find a product, you look at the store, 100,000 SKUs, dozens of aisles, go find what you want to find. Is it there? Is it not there? Maybe there is something better. What are promotions are there today? And in the trucks reality, using our technology, consumers will be able to come and really go and seek their own looked after products. They can search what is gluten-free, what is non-animal origin, whatever flavor of their life experience that they want to have. And that is really disrupting not only the industry, but shopping as a whole.
So is it going to reduce the amount of product that's in these grocery stores? It's out of control. 100,000 SKUs? I mean, how many flavors of, no offense to the General Mills, but how many flavors of Cheerios do we need?
Part of the difficulty in creating our disruption is really the ability to capture those 100,000 SKUs and recognize them in this level of accuracy, where basically in real time. So we are completely agnostic to the fact that products are changing. 30% of SKUs in the industry are changing every year. And we can capture all of that part of our technology and system that are learning as they progress in their capturing of the shelves. And this is all kind of technology that is already solved.
Okay. Sam, what's disruptive about a virtual assistant? Sounds like a natural.
Yeah, there's many ways to look at disruption. So I think one, disruption is happening all around us anyway. And we're accelerating it by allowing companies to move online if people still consider that disruption has been going on for 15 years or so. But I think probably the most important disruption is going to be in shopper behavior in terms of how people shop. So just to give you an example, I recently bought this smartwatch. I decided I want a watch. The only criteria I had was that it was not going to be an Apple watch. Other than that, I had no idea what I was going for.
You're really a big fan of Apple, it sounds like.
Yeah, I am, yeah, as you can tell. So I went to a couple of stores, talked to sales folks, hoping that somebody would educate me and help me decide what to buy. Didn't work out, so I went online, probably spent 5 or 6 hours researching smartwatches across the board, and finally, through a lot of pain and agony, went and came to the decision about what I was going to buy. Now, with a virtual sales assistant, the kind that we're building, that process should maybe take 5 or 10 minutes. You go there, it understands your motivations, understands your requirements, knows everything about every product that's out there, and can very quickly fit the right product to your buying criteria or priorities. So that's our goal. And we're pretty close to it in the categories that we build things for, but obviously, or built a solution for, but obviously it's an ongoing journey. But I think that's the biggest change that we're going to see in the marketplace, where people are able to make decisions about complex products, about products where they have a lot of choices, as you just mentioned, and where they have personal concerns, being able to quickly make decisions comfortably and confidently to make a purchase.
All right, I'm going to throw out a question that they have no prompting for, so this is the bonus question. What was the lowest point in your entrepreneurial life as a startup entrepreneur? What was like the nadir?
So I talked about the successful companies. There have also been companies that didn't go anywhere. And so there's lots of low points. But I think the lowest point was when I actually joined a startup that had been one of my first startups, had been around for a while. They brought me on pretty late, said they had some runway, and 3 months later informed everybody that they could either leave or go on minimum wage because the company had run out of money. And fortunately, everybody took minimum wage because that was a law. You couldn't work for free. But it wasn't so much a nadir for me personally in terms of how I viewed it, but it was an unfortunate situation that every employee in the company had been put in, and it was not the best time to be going out and looking for jobs and things like that. So these kind of things happen in startups, which typically I don't think you would experience.
And this didn't dissuade you from being an entrepreneur again?
No. It's about getting up every morning and being excited about what you do. I had the misfortune of joining a larger company as part of a retention with one of my recent exits, and it was the most painful 1 year of my life.
Okay, Joel, lowest point as an entrepreneur.
There were many low points. I get past of being an entrepreneur is accepting the fact that your life is going to be miserable and a lot of pressure and a lot of low points, a few high points. But I would say that today Trax is quite a fairly big company. Some people don't call it a startup. We operate in 50 countries, close to $100 million in revenues. It's a big corporation. But when we started, it was a small team that was really focused on solving the problem. And that was kind of the same startup that you have in your kind of imagination of people in the garage building. It's all starting from our own living rooms and working together. And as the company started to grow and to become bigger, suddenly you find out as a CEO that instead of focusing on the target of solving and making happy clients happy, you start with politics and people fighting with one another, and suddenly the most important thing is what is my title and what is my role as the company grows. And that was, for me, the biggest frustration and the big kind of, you call it, the lowest point, where the standardly comes, the company comes to a halt, and not because the technology is not good, not because the market is not there, not because the clients are not happy, just because people cannot find a way to work together. So that was the lowest point. I took external consulting. We changed the structure of the management, and the company took off again. But for me, that was the most frustrating part.
Interesting. Asaf, lowest point.
So the lowest point for us was a big one. We started, me and two of my friends, started our first company, Wepic. It was a startup, three people in a garage, lucky the stories. We grew up to be more than 200 employees in less than 2 years. For 5 years, we generate a lot of revenue, and we had a huge success. Most of our people were our friends and friends of friends and family. And then we needed to shut down the business because of Google. This has happened to a lot of companies on the internet. Google just moving you to the side, and you have no choice. And on 2015, we just needed to fire more than 150 people in 1 day, including my sister, you know. And after you build something from nothing and you generate a lot of success, it's very difficult to see everything collapse. But we are still here, and we're winning for the second time. That company, is after being 20 people, is having 80 employees, doing something a little bit different online. So we're winning again there. And we're here, the same group, the same people. We have investors that are believing us and helping us move forward all the time. So it's all about losing, because this is the only way you can win once again and generate more power.
Francis.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. It's all pretty hard, and you find a new low every day. Lexet is a pretty new company, so we haven't really hit our low yet. So far, it's all been very exciting and starting off well. But this is my second venture, and I, you know, the hardest part is getting started. In my last company, I started in my living room, just on my own credit cards, and you know, it gets incredibly difficult until you get that first deal or that first investment. And you know, anybody who's been through this, I think everyone can attest that it gets very difficult in the beginning until you get that first bit of funding and someone believes in you.
Good. Well, I've just got 30 seconds or so to wrap up. My encouragement to all of you as brands and stores is to not drag out the decision-making process of whether to work with a startup or not. If you're not going to work with them, just say no. It's not a hard question or hard answer. Just make it clear and fast. And the reason why is startups have only one thing that they're conserving right now, which is cash, right? They're trying to build a business fast enough to generate more business, et cetera. And so the process by which you decide on innovation is completely yours. No one's challenging you. But make your decisions quickly and move on with it. So these folks, all of the folks in this room and the entire conference, can move forward as well. There's nothing worse than silence. It's just like, it's the worst experience I personally felt. My worst days were where I was not getting an answer. I would rather hear no than hear nothing. I don't know how you all felt about it, but
Absolutely. In
our future, you know, a no is actually a good piece of information to get. it helps refine our business and challenge us. So with that, you've gotten inside the minds of the entrepreneur a little bit. Please spend some time with them and enjoy the rest of the show. Thank you.
Thank you.